Welcome back to the Blue Door Pub Thunderdome for another Boo with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87th best daily podcast, a show about everything and nothing 5 days a week. Sports adjacent, even though today has absolutely nothing to do about sports. It's all right. Sin Shotgun is Uncle Nick. Follow him on Twitter at Nickerson. Hey, how's it going, Nick?
Going great, Andy.
Happy Monday.
Yay, Monday, beginning of the week.
Did you want to kill yourself? If you did off yourself, what? tell a friend, spread the word. iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio, bullshow.co. Also, like us on Facebook, facebook.com/bullshow. Grow my leaps and bounds there. Get it, girl. Also on YouTube. Yeah. If you did off yourself, how would you do it? You seem like a pill guy.
How do you seem like a pill guy?
Well, of all the various ways to kill yourself, I feel like pills is the easiest way out because, you know, some people cut. It seems like a bit much. Some people do the gun thing. I think I would be a pill person too.
I mean, obviously, no one wants to off themselves in like a painful manner. Like, oh yeah, I'm gonna car crash myself because obviously there's a chance to feel an intense pain. I feel like pills, I mean, it's scary to say, is also like the most accidental way to kill yourself. I mean, there's so many, obviously, celebrities galore.
Oh, yeah, medication. Yeah, Michael Jackson on.
Who just accidentally, people who
come
take one too many Advil or, you know, ibuprofen, I mean, you're killing your liver. I mean, it's bound to happen by pills anyway, I think 90% of the time.
So to come on, get some.
I would...
Yeah, I don't know if I could do, like, gun or shotgun, you know, the way Kurt Cobain was killed by the gardener. Yeah. I mean, I'm trying to get to the part in the Shooting Star by Bad Company where Johnny died one night. Is it towards the end?
I don't know what part when that is.
Oh, there it is. All right, here we go. Johnny died one night. Died in his bed. Bottle of whiskey, sleeping turbulence by the bed. Johnny's life passing by like a warm summer day. If you listen to the wind, you'll hear him play. All right, so Johnny became a rock star. Booze and pills. That's how it goes. Don't know if it was accidental or if it was intentional. Bad Company never specifies.
Very great underrated band, Bad Company.
I love that like 3/4 of their songs about from Bad Company were about being in the band Bad Company.
Oh, yeah. Like one of my favorite songs is Bad Company. Bad Company. What's your favorite Bad Company song? Bad Company.
All right. So starting off on a bright and cheery Monday. So did you pick pills?
Yeah, I'll pick this.
Well, how are some other ways that people kill? Hanging could not do.
I thought about the strangle. There's obviously hang.
David Carradine?
Yeah. Obviously,
look that up, children.
I wonder, what's the one, the carbon monoxide, whatever.
Oh, I think that one, that one would be easy too.
I don't know. I just, no.
Or, like, intentionally driving in traffic. Bad Company.
We on the show do not condone doing any of the stuff, by the way.
We do condone Bad Company.
Bad Company is definitely
Bad Company. They're a good band. Oh, there it is.
I would see them at like a festival somewhere. They're playing at a county fair somewhere.
Yeah, Bad Company seems like a band you see at Treasure Island. It's why they call me Bad Company. All right, so bring it up.
I see them touring with. I'm gonna see if they actually are touring right now. Maybe they can sponsor or something. I see them like co-doing like a concert tour with like the Doobie Brothers or something or a BTO.
Tonight only at the Maurer County Fairgrounds, Bad Company with Winger and Messina from Lockins and Messina. Buy a ticket, get a free corn dog, an entrance to the tractor pool. Sunday.
Bad Company is playing Red Rocks Amphitheater in Colorado in May 15th.
Really? Everyone says the Red Rocks Amphitheater is pretty sweet.
Yeah, I was there. I was there. It was pretty pretty cool.
Did you see a concert?
Or no, no. There? I was there with me and Peepers went. I toured it when I was there a few years ago.
All right, so Beauty and the Beast. The wife and I had a date night on Saturday evening, and it was very lovely. Also, I want to make a movement of when you go on a date, the cliche dinner and a movie, that the movie should come first before dinner.
Ooh, clever.
Yeah, because I feel like most people, maybe some people, you know, do this, where it's movie, then dinner. But I do feel like most people do the dinner, then a movie. And, you know, they'll get dinner at like 7. They'll see a 9 o'clock movie, blah, blah, blah. But there's so many time variables with dinner. You know, like movies start when it starts. Although, I love movie trailers, except all the stupid Coca-Cola commercials and all the passive-aggressive commercials about, hey, shut your phone off. We went Beauty and the Beast. It was at 3 o'clock start. It didn't start till 3:18.
I like that you timed it specifically to 3:18.
I look because I love movie trailers. That's why I love getting to movies early to see the trailers. That's actually probably my favorite part. But interspersed with all the stupid, I drink a Coke, Coke is life. And hey, Beatrice the Bear says, turn off your phone. Don't be a dick. Cool. And we get it. Awesome. Nice. Also, does Coke need to advertise anymore? We had this debate because instead of talking about life and philosophical issues, this is what I talk about in the with the wife in the car about. Does Coke and McDonald's and Nike actually need to advertise anymore?
I think so. I don't think it has to be as big a tone, but I mean, there's always younger demographics that don't know that stuff.
You're incorrect. it is my rebuttal.
Was Margaret's first word, Daddy, I want a Coke? No.
Nah, she's more of a Pepsi gal, but we'll work on that. So bringing it back to the dinner, there's so many time variables with dinner. You just offed yourself. Time variables and dinner where, like, you could it could be a while to get seated, even if you have a reservation. Service could be slow. Maybe you want to take your time. Maybe you want to get dessert. Maybe you want to get an appetizer. Maybe you want to get an extra drink. All that factors into getting to the movie on time. And, you know, if you're going out, you want to have fun. You don't want to be stressed like, oh, shit. We're going to miss the movie time. So go to the movie first. You know exactly when it's going to start. You know exactly when it's going to end. Then go to dinner. You can talk about the movie. And especially if it's an early first date or second date or something, and you know that the person doesn't really have a personality, you just want to get your bang on, you can talk about the movie. Because if you're at dinner beforehand, what are you going to talk about? Trump?
The excitement to see the movie?
I saw the trailer. It looks really good. Yeah, great. Cool.
Shut up. That's why all my first dates fail.
Yeah. And also, once you have married dates where you're not trying to impress each other, or if you've been with the person for a long time, which is amazing, because if you go on like a first date and if it's someone that you, well, obviously you don't know on a first date or an early date, like first, second, third, and like, oh, you know, I really want to get the 16-ounce prime rib, except I'll get something small, or I'll get a salad. I'm still trying to impress this person. No, we'll pass on dessert, blah, 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 because, oh, maybe we'll get lucky later. Mm-hmm. But when you're married or in a committed relationship, you're like, all right, bring on the 16-ounce prime rib, bring on the appetizer, bring on the dessert. Oh, we got some extra dessert. Cool. And so you're going to get completely full up and bloated. You don't want to go sit in a dark room for 2 hours. Nah, that's a little much.
I'm picturing it right now. Yeah. It's so weird.
So see the movie first and then go out to dinner. We need to establish that. That's going to be my new executive order. I decree it.
I like that idea. That actually sounds very clever.
Yeah. And, oh, man, you have no idea. This might be a parenting thing, but even if we didn't have kids, the notion of going to a 3 o'clock movie or a matinee, getting an early dinner, and then being at home by like 7 or 8, amazing. It's amazing.
Oh, no, I totally love that. I totally love
And, yeah, I mock old people relentlessly for getting dinner at like 4 o'clock at Denny's. I understand it now.
Makes sense. It makes sense. It all comes together.
Yeah, because if you get home too late, you go to bed, right? Or if you stay up and watch TV, and then all of a sudden it's 1 and 2 in the morning, and then you're like, feh. But we got home at 8. I watched 4 episodes of The People vs. O.J. Simpson, which I'm finally starting to get into. It was amazing. And I was in bed by midnight. What a great date night.
I love sleep. I love sleep. I love doing everything early. So.
All right, so Beauty and the Beast. We're going to play the trailer. I have a couple critiques of it. Overall, I like the movie. It was good. I think it was faithful to the animated version of 1901. Apparently, this is based off of a 17th century fable, which most Disney movies probably are. Like Moana, it's all about a fable.
Yeah.
Europe fable.
A number of Disney films are all like Hans Christian Andersen. You can time back. I think Cinderella was an old 1700s storyline.
Which probably explains why all the princesses are white, because they're written by white people from medieval Europe.
Yeah.
Except for Moana. Gather around, children, before you get the Black Plague. Let me tell you about a girl on an island in a place that we don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Moana's a good movie.
Blimey, I thought the only island was this island. You mean Moana? She's floating away to Ireland?
No.
Or perhaps the Isle of Man, which is in between England and Ireland. Yeah. Anyways. All right, so Beauty and the Beast. Emma Watson, amazing. Like Hermione done grown up. Emma Watson is both beautiful and hot, which aren't mutually exclusive. And also, she seems to have a personality where she'd be cool to hang out with. Like she would fart on you and laugh at it.
I did read once that with fans, however, if they ask, if you try to ask her for a selfie, she does decline.
I feel like a lot of celebrities are into that nowadays.
I feel like there are a lot who aren't, like the ones who are like the B-celebrities who like, I just want work. Come on, TMZ.
All right, so who the hell is this?
Bell.
That's Kevin Kline's dad.
Ahead of your time.
She got the townspeople hate her because she's trying to teach little girls how to read.
As Beauty and the Beast was a 90s classic for us.
This is the only French town ruled by Sharia law.
And then, when you're older, you don't see that, but when you're younger, you don't see that subtleness of it. But yeah, I remember the cartoon version of Beauty and the Beast, and there was a scene where Gaston's Chris has his bell, what's up with all you and all this reading? You know, reading's going to lead to you thinking, and I'm whoa, what?
Small village. You are the most gorgeous thing I've ever seen. Nobody deserves you.
And it's small-minded as well.
But small also means safe.
Was he still an inventor?
Huh?
Was he an inventor?
My father.
Yeah, kind of.
He's a thief.
Come into the light.
Kill him.
I will escape, I promise.
Right, here's one of my major issues is that you saw from the CGI Beast is that they made him still aesthetically pleasing, which was distracting. Like his face is still the traditional, strong chin, symmetrical, kind of. He's a handsome looking beast. They should have had one droopy eye, one nostril, a lisp, and his mouth protruding over the side like he had a stroke. That would be the Beast.
No comment.
Or with the Gilbert Gottfried voice. Bow. Bell, I'm the pair from Aladdin.
Girl. Who said that?
Hello.
What? You can talk.
Hello, court. It's all he ever does.
It's a Lumiere and the stupid clock.
Want to see me do a trick? What happens when the last petal falls?
The Mastel remains a beast.
Fun fact, Chip, played by Kevin Hart.
Forever.
And we become antiques.
What?
No.
What did you do to it?
Nothing.
Get out of here! Go!
Attacked by wolves and shit. Yeah. I guess it was Beauty that killed the Beast.
If she is the one.
So pretty honest with the
you must finally learn to learn.
It's pretty much, except there's some extra have you really read every one of these books? Songs in there.
Some of them are in Greek. True as it can be.
Down that blouse. All right, I see the idea. It was also a little distracting that you couldn't tell who the voices were because they're all speaking in accents. Like, I had my guesses, and unless you look beforehand in the movie, which I did not, you did not know that Ewan McGregor and Ian McKellen and Emma Thompson were, Stanley Tucci were like all the. Lumiere and Cogsworth and like the stupid teapot and the harpsichord, blah blah blah. They're like Monopoly pieces.
I think the original cartoon had a lot of all-star voices as well. It's great to see these actors out of character, out of the characters that we usually see in, into weird, you know. What, do you call this stop motion animation, or what kind of animation do you call it?
CGI.
CGI.
No. Stop motion would be like The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Okay, yeah.
God, how long would that take? All right, now he's got to do the Macarena. Shit, that's going to take a month.
Beauty and the Beast, 2020.
So the whole controversy around Josh Gad's character, LeFou, being gay, it's like, all right, so there's two scenes where it was sort of strongly hinted that he was gay. There was a scene where before Gaston has his whole song and dance routine where he sitting behind Gaston, like rubbing his head, and then Gaston's like, that's a little too far. And then during the scene where the townspeople invade the castle, the wardrobe lady, like, takes these three kind of tough-looking guys, dresses them up like women, and then one of the guys is kind of like, all right. I feel right, Brian. I feel right. And then that continues into the last scene when there's a dance. Spoiler alert, no one cares. Where LeFou and this guy that was fancy when he was dressed up, they start dancing together, and then they lock eyes, and then that's it. So it's like, yeah, we get it. He's gay. It's fine. No one really cares. And that's this whole scene that they're talking about where we talked earlier about, like, Alabama, like, banning it from a drive-thru and blah, 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 and everyone's saying, this is so brave. It's like, no, it's not really brave. It's like, who cares? Like, yeah, we get it. There's gay people. It's not a big deal. Wait until there's a gay princess.
Ooh, that
is on the horizon.
That's a good one. That will be, and I will watch it. That'll be...
Although, Disney is quasi-bulletproof, but I feel like there would be more controversy around that, even from, like, open-minded, progressive people, that it's like, I don't know, it's a little much. Well, do you think there would be more controversy over a lesbian princess or a gay prince?
Lesbian, I think.
Like if Wally was just railing another male robot, like him and C-3PO were just.
I think the lesbian one might be a little much.
I feel like they do it very subtly though. Like she wouldn't be part of a bowling team.
All I'm picturing is like
the bowling team princess.
The Family Guy, Elvira, the mega lesbians.
Except what I thought was funny is that Josh Gad. Who plays the gay guy in the movie is straight, and then Luke Evans, who plays the extremely straight guy in the movie Gaston, is extremely gay in real life.
That's funny.
Like
how
that Hugh Jackman level gay. Hugh Jackman's not gay, but you know what I mean.
Hey, it works for some people.
Also, the spoiler for the ending: the prince, this jabroni named Dan Stevens, who I guess is in Downton Abbey.
Yep.
Yeah. So once he gets released from the spell, he just has, he looks like Kato Kaelin. He's got the long, like, Californian hair, and, like, they just leave it long. And he's like, princess, belle,
I remember as a kid seeing Beauty and the Beast in the theater, and I remember when, spoiler alert for that one, if you haven't seen that, which I'm sure you have, when Beast transforms to the human, I was shocked. I thought he looked worse. I thought he looked more worse when he transformed into the prince. I liked him better when he looked as a beast.
Yeah. I don't know. But overall, it is a good movie. It is entertaining. The wife enjoyed it, and she's a big fan of the 1991 animated version. Oh, by the way, I always thought it was sort of comical, you know, like when there was VHSs and DVDs to an extent where Disney movies would be like, the Disney movie XYZ is going into the vault. It'll never be released again. Except for in 4 years when they come out with like an extra special platinum edition, right? And there's nowhere where you can buy Beauty and the Beast where it's under $20. Like, you can't buy the digital version, you can't buy the DVD anywhere where it's not under $20.
No, Disney is very smart with their movie releases. Yeah. They do it periodically. It's like the McRib, and then flocks of people are going to try getting it, especially with technology going to Blu-ray, going to HD Blu-ray, 3D HD Blu-ray. I mean, you can keep releasing. You can do special editions, behind-the-scenes stuff. And I'm a sucker for behind-the-scenes. Like, I love all the, I love the fancy super editions. And yeah, Disney can get away with selling them for $30.
What's your favorite behind-the-scenes movie that you've seen?
Let me think. What was a really good one I watched? All the Avengers, all the superhero movie ones have pretty good ones. I'm trying to think. There's one movie in particular that I bought. I'm trying to remember what the name of it was. Where the movie, when it came, when I bought it, it didn't have special features. I had to wait at least 6 months for them to re-release it with special features, and I was super pissed off about it. I think it was. I think Wreck-It Ralph. I think Wreck-It Ralph had that issue.
All right. The wife, she kind of finds it annoying when I inject logic and reason into like these fantasy worlds and, you know, fiction. But it's like, all right. So the time they're in like Provence area of France, right? Which was super distracting because everyone has a British accent except for the stupid candlestick. Where it's like, this is not an area of France that was dominated by the British. This isn't Brittany or Normandy. Like, why does everyone speak English? I digress. Also, period-wise, you see, like, there's a couple muskets, but they're still in sort of the Three Musketeer era. So it's like mid-1700s, mid to sort of late 1700s, and the French Revolution is coming up. And the French Revolution, they just chopped the heads off of, like, all the oligarchs, like, all the royalty, everyone who had money. So they may happily ever after my ass, the Beast and Belle are going to get their heads chopped off, and the people are going to come take their money. It's happening.
That will be sad.
Yeah. And they established early on in the movie, too, that, oh, the prince heavily taxed the townspeople so he could throw lavish balls. You don't think people remember that? Yeah. Once they storm the Bastille, they're going to storm Beast's castle. They're going to cut his head off. And all their kids, too. It's going to be great. Yeah, try singing your way out of this, Belle.
Beauty and the Beast 2. The townspeople's revenge.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast 2. Viva la France! Oh, we come in, we cut off Belle's head off.
I do think the Disney world is supposed to be different from the real world, so I don't think it's supposed to happen that way, but...
And isn't the Beauty and the Beast castle the Disney castle? From the logo?
It might be. It could be, yeah. It could be Cinderella's or Sleeping Beauty's.
Ooh, also, the demographics of the town was pretty distracting. Now, they went pretty hardcore on the interracial couples of the servants that turned back into humans again. Which is fine. I mean, I'm an interracial couple. It's just how the world is. It is a little weird how ham-fisted they are about it, which is fine. But the townspeople, The scene where they're introducing the townspeople is like, oh, no, she's like walking around in Brooklyn or Williamsburg. Like, what the hell is going on? I blame Hamilton for all this. Because, like, oh, I'm going to go to the fish guy who's Puerto Rican. How'd they get a Puerto Rican in Provence, France?
That's nitpicking it a little bit.
Well, no. Here's the thing.
I want my movie to be white. Whites only.
No, I just wanted to be period correct. Except they're all about diversity. They went all in except there's no Asian guy. Like, how is there no eight? Like, oh, you come in and buy my silk bed.
Was there no?
Where's the opium den in the stupid Provence town?
Was there no magical talking washer and dryer? Because that would be the Asians.
Oh, come in the Samsung. Oh, well, there's a scene where she's washing her clothes, so that should have been the Samsung.
Yeah, right.
Product placement. Shame on you, Disney, for making a culturally diverse cast, which is not historically accurate, and completely ignoring the Asians. Like, where's the Indian guy? They completely ignored 2.5 billion people on this planet.
They're still paying for the movie.
Yeah.
Sorry, quick question. To talk about the ending of the film, they all changed all the what do you call it, the creatures or whatever. Mm-hmm. They all changed back into humans, correct?
Yep.
Are they recognizable as who's the cast there? Ewan McGregor, Ian McKellen. Do they as actors show up as themselves?
Yeah. And what they should have done to nitpick further is that in the opening scene, unless I completely missed it, they only established Stanley Tucci and Audra McDonald as servants. Like, those are the only two faces I recognize that turned into the. Mm-hmm. Yeah, the blah blah blah, but they should have shown like Ewan McGregor, Ian McKellen, Emma Thompson
all turning into their
significant
pieces.
Okay. Because they completely could have, and I might have just missed that quick little split cut, but I don't think I did. And then people wouldn't have had gone through the entire movie of like, who is Lumiere? Who is Lumiere? Is it Kevin Hart? Is it The Rock? Is The Rock Lumiere? There's two Disney movies for The Rock this year.
Lumiere.
Yeah. And also, the singing. The singing was good. And also, it wasn't, distracting. Like, Moana's a really good movie. That's up there as one of my favorite Disney movies because it's not annoying over the top. Like, I don't think kids fully went all in, like, on Frozen.
I like that you like it because it's not annoying.
Yeah, I like it because it hasn't been driven to the ground yet. You know, it's not like Imagine Dragons. But it was cool. Distracting when The Rock tried to sing. And you could tell that was very cleaned up and scrubbed and auto-tuned a little bit. But the singing in Beauty and the Beast, like Emma Watson can sing. Like, she's definitely not Emma Stone or Emma Roberts or Emma Thompson for that matter.
I loved it when The Rock sang in that thing. Sorry.
What can I say except, can you smell what The Rock's cooking?
That's how it should have been.
Yeah. all right, so, bit of a funny story. After dinner, I...
What'd you have for dinner?
Had 16-ounce ribeye, and then we had, I really like how... Places are doing like house-made tater tots, you know, where it's not like out of the bag, toss in the fryer. No, it's actually like legit. Like, oh, we cook these potatoes, we chopped them up, we formed them into tots, and there's like stuff with cheese and stuff is really good. And then we had dessert. The wife had a soup and like this really like hardcore salad, which is really awesome. And so after dinner, we're leaving, and then all of a sudden, I get a little grumbling in the tumbling, you know what I mean? And it's weird to, so we're in the parking lot. It'd be weird to just go back into the restaurant to take a dump, right? But it's not weird to go into a Starbucks, which is right next door, to take a dump. So that's what I did. And it was pretty fortunate that it wasn't like a situation where, it wasn't like in Bridesmaids when... the lady runs out into the street and is like, it's happening. It's happening. It's happened. I could have held it. It would have been fine. But I was like, all right. And the Starbucks bathroom is right in front. And it's actually sort of hidden from, like, the main people, like, the main ordering desk, which is nice because then you don't have to make eye contact with them. Because you know how many X number of people a day just come to Starbucks and take a dump? Like, any random Starbucks. Probably a lot. And it's always weird walking in, and then you look at the cashier, and then you just walk into the bathroom, and they're like, how dare you? How dare you? But I always feel bad doing that, so I order a coffee, even though it was at, like, 8 o'clock at night, because, that's basically I'm paying $2 to take a dump in your place. It's the same sort of trade-off as people who buy a small coffee and then sit there on the Wi-Fi for 8 hours.
It's one of those common courtesy things, yeah. I think, is what you're trying to talk about.
Or do you think – I feel like places like Starbucks should go a step further. Instead of having them buy a coffee, which they don't really want or not going to drink anyways, just have them tip like $2. Just toss $2 into the thing. It's like, oh, yeah.
We know I did.
The dump jar. It's separate from the tip jar. Just leave a couple bucks.
That goes to a higher percentage to the janitor who works. And we know there's no janitor.
What do you say we do? Yeah. So, that's my dump story. We'll be right back with more Boo with Andy Carlson on a Monday.
I got a fever, and the only prescription is more Purple for the Win podcast with Andy Carlson. Come to you all off-season long, covering free agency, the draft, OTAs, and then we're on to training camp. Get the show on 1500 ESPN, Podcast One, and the Podcast One app.
And come back into the Blue Door Pub Thunderdome, baby. And, oh, man. If you got an event coming up, wedding, corporate parties. Oh, graduation. That's coming up, too. Yeah. Oh, summertime, getting some people together. Do that up because they got Blue Door Catering now. Catering from 12 to gazillion, which is a big number. No matter how many people you got, as long as more than 12, order up some catering from Blue Door. And they got a full menu. And also, they take customized orders because that's what they do. I mean, Pat German, they'll work with you. It's what they do. Blue, as far as the menu, Blue Sea Bar, mini Blue Seas, tachos, wings, apps like Spam Bites. Nick, you know the Spam Bites.
I love the Spam Bites.
And also, ooh, the Latin Kisses. See, what you do, it's like a jalapeno popper, except it's wrapped in bacon. It's just got a little bit of brown sugar on it. It's amazing. It's sweet. It's savory. It's everything. It's hot. Yeah. TheBDP.com/catering to get the full details on there. Do that up. I think I'm going to get Blue Door Pub Catering sometime this summer. Just have people over.
It'll be good. I would do that.
Yeah. What do you think was that, Danish? TheBDP.com. Do that up. All right. So we're coming back, and Chuck Berry died on Saturday, age of 90. Sad. Sad.
Yeah, it's I'd say it's heartbreaking, but I mean, age of 90, you know.
That's a good run.
I don't argue that, like, oh, it's your time to go. I mean, it's just, to be honest, you know, I mean, that's a long life to live. And, you know, I think we all talk about 2016 was the year of celebrity deaths, and...
Oh my God, 2016.
And 2017, there have been celebrity deaths, but I feel like there hasn't been too many iconic names who've passed, and I don't know. It's just this might be one of the first harder ones for me because I do love Chuck Berry was rock and roll when it started out. The like 50s, that was the heart of how like modern music would all come from his generation. He, you know, had a number of great hits for an African American in the 50s, you know, during a time when, you know, he couldn't use certain bathrooms or he wasn't allowed in certain entrances.
He wasn't allowed in that Starbucks bathroom.
Yeah, it's fucking, it's hype, you know, it's, you know, he'd been through so much. And my grandmother bought me a cute little toy. Oh, silver bells hanging on a string. She told me it was my ding-a-ling-a-ling. Oh, my
That's my favorite Chuck Berry song. What's your favorite Chuck Berry song, Nick?
I do like Roll Over Beethoven's one of my favorites. Johnny Be Good. A lot of people like that. What's it called? Madeline.
Maybelline.
Maybelline is a highly underrated one too.
Now, was he talking about the composer Beethoven or the large great
Saint Bernard?
Yeah, from the 90s movies.
He's obviously talking about Saint Bernard.
Yeah. You're telling me that Chuck Berry's song from 1956 is about a loving Saint Bernard from the 1990s movie hit Beethoven?
Correct.
You know my temperature rising. Ooh, legit question. Do you think they named the movie Beethoven because of the song Roll Over Beethoven?
Yes. No, no.
Or do you think, hey, we can turn Charles Grodin to a star?
Rest in peace.
Wait, is he dead?
No, no, he's not. I think he's still alive.
Oh, his career is dead.
His career has been gone. The thing, if I remember the movie correctly, yep. He was called Beethoven because I think one of the daughters was practicing Beethoven's fifth, da 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 da, and Beethoven was singing with it, so like Beethoven, like something like being so upset that they got a dog.
Yeah. I thought it was, the thing that still stands out to me about the movie Beethoven is that the daughter's name was Rice. Who names their kid Rice?
Asians.
Besides Asian.
I don't know.
Yeah. But with Chuck Berry, we'd be remiss if we didn't revisit one of the most iconic movie scenes in cinema history.
All right. All right, this is an oldie.
But, this is an oldie.
Well, it's an oldie where I come from. All right, guys, listen, this is a blues riff from B. Watch me for the changes and try and keep up, okay?
Oh, wait. Or this is what I do, just interrupt movie clips. So this is distracting, where when Michael J. Fox is clearly not singing, and they clearly got someone way better to sing. It doesn't even sound like him.
So. Okay. Johnny Be Good came out in 1958. Wait now. The movie is taking place in 1955.
Johnny Be Good.
Hey, here's a scene.
Chuck, it's Marvin. Your cousin, Marvin Berry. You know that new sound you're looking for? Well, listen to this.
Hitting that Michael J. Fox help upgrade his guitar.
So it's heavily implied that Chuck Berry ripped off Calvin Klein.
I think my Facebook announcement was like rest in peace to him about like rest in peace to Chuck Berry for creating such great covers as Johnny B. Goode.
Yeah, rest in peace, Chuck Berry. This is what happens to plagiarizers.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, what happens on Monday is the news.
You are fake news.
Sir,
go ahead. Can you...
George Bush doesn't care about black people.
America. Ain't got time to bleed.
You can't handle the truth.
The news with Uncle Nick.
Straight cash, homie.
Straight cash, homie.
All right, Nick, what we got today?
All right, this first news article, I had to find a couple articles to make sure this actually, what I was reading made sense, but has to do with grammar. From NPR.
Country grammar? Doon, 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 doon. Hot shit.
Whoa, Nelly.
I'm going down. Whatever happened to Nelly? Sorry, God.
I think he lives in Minnesota now.
No, he's living in the hall of... Wait, no. That's not his song. Sorry, God.
I didn't hear. Okay, so... All right. This story I found searching online for just random stories here is about the Oxford comma. Do you know what that is?
It's when you list three things where it's like A, B, C, where it's A, comma, B, comma, and C instead of A, comma, B, and C. Is that it?
Yes, yes. All right. So apparently there was, last week there was a court hearing in which the Oxford comma, if it was used properly, might have saved this company a couple of $1 million in this lawsuit. I'm pulling up the news story from Street Anna Bain. Oh, I think Nelly's in Minnesota. I would look that up. this company called the Oakhurst Dairy was being sued by a number of employees. I think they were complaining about overtime protection costs and regulations. And, quote here, the rulings in favor of the delivery drivers came down, okay, in Maine state law, which dictate the following activities are not subject to overtime protection. The canning, processing, preserving, freezing, drying, marketing, storing, packing for shipment or distribution of, and then one, agricultural produce, meats, fish products, so on and so forth. So that list I was going off on, it said storing, comma, packing for shipment or distribution of. So that statement, shipment or distribution of, because that or is there, let's see, the tiny conjunction without a comma has left the meaning of the statement of what their company states here. Sorry, give me 1 second here.
So basically it leaves it open to interpretation.
Yes.
And so they're on the hook for... the interpretation legally.
Yeah, so it says here the drivers do distribute, but they do not pack the perishable foods. In other words, one interpretation of the law's list would make it that the driver's eligibility for overtime pay, the other would mean that they won't get extra dollars for the extra time pay on the job. So the way that shipment or distribution of, the way that's listed there, a court judge ruled in favor of the delivery drivers because they were distributing, but they weren't packing. So so back pay, I guess, from, let me see here, the overtime
now, see,
pay usage.
This is all just a giant commercial for lawyers. Like the in-house counsel for every company around the country is like, well, I guess we're just going to have some more billable hours because we'll have to go through and look at the language of all of our contracts because you don't want to be like this company with the Oxford comma, do you? Mm.
Yeah, I don't know. Just I thought it was a made-up thing. I thought it was like an Onion article.
Now, Nick, do you use the Oxford comma?
Yes, I do.
I generally don't because I feel like people are smart enough to get the gist as opposed to, yeah. Plus, it looks weird.
I don't mind it. No, I use it all the time. How often do any of us write anymore? I mean, with today's kids nowadays, it's all emojis and Snapchat. So,
well, it's like if you write hot dogs, burgers, and chicken, and if you have the comma in there, you have burgers, comma, and chicken. But if you don't, you have hot dogs, comma, burgers, and chicken. It's like, oh, what's burgers and chicken? I don't know. Is it something I haven't even heard
like
of?
Like a meal or something? A fancy meal?
It's odd. Yeah. What's next?
All right. Second article. Another little political one here.
Also, is this stupid about the grammar police? Like, they're going to come in. I told you. Like, the people who always correct then and there and there. Yeah. We're giving those stupid people power. Because this happens a lot, where people get into arguments on the internet. Like, I don't partake, but it's funny watching people melt down. Is that... whether it's Twitter or a forum or YouTube comments, is that if they don't have anything to say, like if they don't have a comeback or anything, they'll just try and correct the other person's grammar, and then they'll declare victory and then slink away. It's like, ha-ha, I am superior because I know the correct form of then and then. You frequently use the incorrect version of then and then, don't you?
No.
Yeah.
I'm always right.
No, you put... I remember this because I remember you writing like a Facebook post and you were saying like, and then this happened, except it was, and then this happened.
Maybe a long time ago. I'm usually a little bit better now. I'll complain a lot on people's grammar.
You learned.
I complain a lot about people's grammar.
You learned proper English grammar after you got out of high school and college.
Yeah.
Which is the normal way.
Yeah. Which is the normal way.
All right. I'm sorry. What's next?
That's fine. All right. I know kind of an interesting story, something we don't think about with Hollywood and politics. Tim Allen has been... Tim Allen was speaking on Jimmy Kimmel last week, and he's kind of the voice of the non-liberals. He's a well-known conservative who typically doesn't voice his stuff out, you know. Obviously, a lot of liberals in Hollywood and a lot of liberals in Hollywood voice their stuff. And Tim Allen, you know, he confesses, you know, like he attended Trump's inauguration.
Mm-hmm.
And he says, quote, "You get beat up if you don't believe what everybody else believes. This is like 30s Germany." So
I get that he's being hyperbolic there, but he does have a point. Where the left looks into fighting fascism. We have the clip.
Oh, excellent.
Into fighting fascism with fascism, where it's like when they're shutting down conservative speakers on college campuses. And I get it. Like, hate speech, like, Milo Yiannopoulos is hate speech. But once you're lumping in other conservatives like Ben Shapiro into that group, that's a little bit over the pale.
I was invited by...
here's Tim Allen talk about the inauguration.
Vets and went to the Veterans Ball, and so I went to go see the Democrats and Republicans. Yeah, I went to the inauguration. I'm not kidding. You got to be real careful around here. You know, you get beat up. If you don't believe what everybody believes, this is like 30s Germany. I don't know what happened. If you're not part of the group, you know what we believe is right. I go, well, I might have a problem with that. I'm a comedian. I like going on both sides.
Yeah.
This government does stuff big. I've never been to anything like that.
Was it a big deal?
Just so many people. And when they show up, you know, the ex-president gets in a helicopter and there's jets and Marines taking him this way, another, and there's parade.
But, yeah, it is weird when you see a Hollywood conservative because, I feel like there is a bit of ostracism. Maybe not full-on blacklisting like in the 50s and 60s with writers who were even thought of to have communist sympathies and ties. Trumbo, you know, with Bryan Cranston, is a great movie about that. But, yeah, I feel like if a celebrity comes out and is very outspoken on conservative values or support of Trump, the way that liberals are outspoken, I feel like they'll have a hard time finding work. Maybe that's why Charles Grodin hasn't worked in a long time. Maybe he's a hardcore Republican.
That would not surprise. I think he just got bored of the work and bored of Hollywood and just got out of it.
Where for Tim Allen, you know, you're on your second successful sitcom that's gone to syndication, Last Man Standing. I haven't watched it, but I heard it's pretty good. You can get away with saying a few more things because you got more leeway. You got clout. Yeah, cash in the bank.
Yeah, I think a lot of it is like he's not going overboard with saying too much. I mean, this on Jimmy Kimmel is nothing, you know. If he was writing on a blog complaining 24/7, I mean, then you'll... then he'll get a lot more hype. But, I mean, Tim Allen is kind of a golden boy. He's pretty – I think he's pretty safe from ridicule. I mean, this is a guy who got arrested in the early 80s, I think, for cocaine.
Yeah, he served time in prison.
For smuggling cocaine, and that's just mind-blowing how Home Improvement's Tim Allen.
Now, I want to see the episode of Home Improvement where they take on the hot-button issue of, like, Muslim immigration. Like, they're coming into Detroit, like, taking up all the factory jobs, and Tim Allen's like, oh, no.
Did you ever see the Home Improvement episode where the oldest son got caught with drugs, and then, like, Tim Allen should have just been like, hey, I've been there. But actually, it was the mom who admitted she did drugs back in the day.
What?
Yeah. On the show. I don't know if Patricia Richardson really did.
This is a great show. Like, this probably in my top five as far as sitcoms.
The middle child got first billing over the oldest and the youngest.
He's Jonathan Taylor Thomas. And, like, the young one got weird. What game show did Richard, that guy host?
I think he did a Family Feud, a version of the Family Feud, and maybe Hollywood Squares, maybe.
I feel like I could host Family Feud.
Anyone can host Family
Feud. Doom, 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 doom. Oh, thanks for the resounding
compliment. I'm just saying, oh, you know what's crazy? I learned, you remember the show, America's Funniest Home Videos?
Yeah.
You know who hosts that now?
Alfonso Ribeiro?
Yeah.
Alfonso, were you on Silver Spoons? Yes, I was. Tim Allen, on October 2nd, 1978, Allen was arrested in the Kalamazoo Battle Creek International Airport for possession of over 650 grams, 1.43 pounds of cocaine. I love the cocaine. Subsequently pled guilty to drug trafficking charges and provided the names of other dealers in exchange for a sentence of 3 to 7 years. Oh, how did Tim Allen not get murdered?
Oh, my God. He's a rat.
Yeah. Rather than a possible life imprisonment, he was paroled on June 12th, 1981, after serving 2 years and 4 months in Federal Correction Institution Sandstone in Sandstone, Minnesota.
Oh, funny. That's so nice. You got to think about this really hard here. If he would have done this in the mid-late 80s and early 90s for sure, the war on drugs was so high. Like, it was Tim Allen could have been in jail forever.
Yeah. I'm surprised he didn't get murdered if you ratted out his suppliers.
I wonder if years from, you know, like, obviously this happened in the 80s. I wonder, like, his peak fame of Home Improvement, his second stint here with his new show. I wonder if he gets all criminals who, like, come back to the door, like, hey, Tim, remember me? Yeah, I sold cocaine out of my Pinto, and you were supposed to sell for me, and you busted me. I want reprimations.
Yeah, I want to know where Tim Allen had that cocaine. Like, I hope it wasn't something as stupid as, like, a false bottom on a water bottle. Like, I hope he had all 1.43 pounds up his ass.
Ugh, gross.
It would prepare him for prison. All right, what's next?
All right, I'll tie in my last two together. NCAA tournament's still going strong. Monday, so we're still, let's see. Oh, the big thing I want to talk about is celebrities' tie-ins with the NCAA tournament. So I hope all you guys' brackets are going well. But some fun little news articles, if you're not a big sports fan like me, is how many celebrities are tied in with NCAA. Two in particular. One of my personal favorites, Bill Murray. Did you know Bill Murray's, I always forget, Bill Murray's a dad. And one of his sons, an adult son, is coach of the college Xavier Musketeers?
Yeah.
Musketeers.
Yeah, Musketeers in Cincinnati. That's cool.
Yeah, so, and so far as of when we're recording this, Xavier has made it through, the second round, I think?
Yeah,
through the second round. How awesome is that?
Except Bill Murray's old, so how old is his kid? Like 65?
I bet it was in his 40s.
Yeah.
And then the second who's getting a lot of buzz is Elaine Benes.
Was.
Oh, yeah. Elaine Benes, a.k.a. Julia Louis-Dreyfus. Her son plays for Northwestern.
Kind of.
He's there.
Yeah.
He's there. And
Julia Louis-Dreyfus of Veep fame.
And that's it.
Yeah.
No, from Christmas Vacation fame.
Oh, yeah, she was the yuppie neighbor, wasn't she? How long do you think it took to write this theme?
If you gave it to Bobby McFerrin, I bet he wrote it in like 5 minutes. I'm kidding, I have no idea who did this.
I feel like sitcom themes or TV show themes is a pretty lucrative market. Because you get paid every time that song gets played. Like the Rembrandts. I'll be there for you.
Unless the executives wrote in their contract, like, listen, I don't know if the show Friends is going to take off. I'll just give you $10,000 straight up front here, you know, and, you know, it'll last maybe a season or two, and then, you know, you guys will be $10,000.
You take that $10,000, you buy Tim Allen's ass cocaine.
I bet one place in the Rembrandts was like, no, let's work a deal, you know, we'll get a low fee, and then we'll just make up on royalties or whatnot if it goes more than 5 seasons. You know, like a nickel every time it's like in syndication. You know, we'd be compounding and having millions down the road. Like, shut up. Shut up, you. We'll take the $10,000 up front.
I'm trying to look it up. Because I'm sure they made, like, some decent bank off of it. That doesn't matter. What's the last story?
Oh, no, that was kind of it. Just talking about how I think Northwestern fell on Saturday.
Yeah, they got beat down by my boys, Gonzaga.
Yeah, so Gorgonzola beat Northwestern. So she's sadly done. I think Xavier is still in it. So pretty exciting. I don't know if you want to talk about
it. It's Xavier. Like, it's not like Professor Xavier.
No, I'm calling it Xavier. No.
Still haven't seen Logan. Kind of bummed about that.
Yeah, it's on my to-do list.
We should go see it. We should do a show during the movie. That'll really make people happy.
That'd be sweet.
Yeah, that's all. That's the news. Your fake news.
The news with Uncle Nick.
From the entire Channel 4 news team, I'm Veronica Corningstone.
And I'm Ron Burgundy. Go f*** yourself, San Diego.
What you got coming up today, Nick? What's going on this week?
Just another mild work week. Nothing exciting.
Just another day of you and me in paradise. Oh.
Definitely a lot of Phil Collins. Twice. Yes.
If you want to support the show, bullshow.co/Amazon. Make sure you get the .co in there. Take it right to the homepage. Bookmark everything. Every time you buy something, use that link, and we'll get a couple nickels in our satchel, and we'll keep on keeping an eye. It's a man purse. Show's available on iTunes, Stitcher, iHeartRadio. Check our YouTube page. Like us on Facebook. All that good stuff. If you enjoy the show, spread the word. Tell a friend. Add to the Jerome Army. And thanks, producer Alex Sorensen, for making me not sound so stupid on a Monday. But for Nick, I'm Andy Carlson, saying and Young. Sayonara and bye-bye. We'll talk to you tomorrow.
Thanks for listening to Bull with Andy Carlson, Minnesota's 87th best daily podcast. Download the show on iTunes. Everyone's middle name is Jerome.